King. Can people hear me? Yes? Okay. So the technology is not perfect here. I had a presentation prepared with lots of videos, and videos also come with sound. So you have to imagine the fantastic soundtracks and the sounds that you are hearing. Maybe I'll talk a little bit through the films. We'll see how it goes. I will improvise a little bit. So I wanted to start showing, before I will say anything, a little clip with a fantastic soundtrack, with music. Okay, well, that was this was my talk in 1 minute. So what I'm going to talk about is the story of Blender, how Blender became of age. Because Blender is actually a very, very old project, which started in 94. In 94, I had a small studio in Eindhoven, in the south of the Netherlands. And in that studio, we were making computer graphics and animation, video graphics, we called it mostly. And we did some 3D as well. And I started to redesign our in-house software, which we were using for rendering and some modeling. And I thought, let's call it Blender. And this picture, what you see here, is the oldest backup I could retrieve. So you can see Blender.c and Blender.h. It has January 2, 1994 as a date stamp. That's the official birthday of Blender. So in the studio of our company, we made mostly models of buildings or product presentations, and all the things that were not really doing film or animation with characters. What you see here is a reel, what we did in the 92 to 96 period. And everything you see has been made with Blender or with our own software that we had in that time. So 25 years old work for clients like who wanted to have a video business or video tapes. Because in the 90s, every self-respecting business had a video, right? And then you had a client coming in and you put the video in the recorder and you showed them the corporate video. You can imagine this is in the same period as Toy Story 1 was being made and released in 95. And of course, we were looking up to this Hollywood, well, because they had much bigger computers and much bigger, better software than we had. But in the end, what you see here is all made with software that runs on 2-4 megabyte computers, right? And in the end, we had 8 megabytes to do things in. And that was a limit of the complexity that you could achieve in 3D. At the final years of the company, I was the founder and the owner of NGO, you could see that the video business would go down. People didn't want to have corporate videos anymore, but instead the internet was coming up, and of course games were coming up. And I decided to add game creation tools in the Blender environment so that people could create a complete game in the tool and then export it to, for example, the PlayStation. So we had an official developer kit, and what you see there is just a game prototype that you could make and play in Blender on the Silicon Graphics system, and I export it into one little Blender file, which you could load on the PlayStation and then play the game with the player there. We tried to do business with that, but nobody believed in it, and everybody said, yeah, cool technology, but what's the game, right? What's the game? This is a game demo. This is not a real playable game. So I decided to sell the company goodwill and clients to another business, and I took the software to a startup center in the University of Eindhoven, but I thought Blender was much cooler than the business I had making video graphics or games. So I founded the company Not a Number. And with Not a Number, it was a one-man company. You can see the room there, that's where I was sitting, that was all we had. The first thing I did was writing a manual and selling it to get some money in. And the business idea was to give away the software for free, but not as open source. But the software was released for everyone for free. Then, very quickly, we did a FreeBSD port first, we did a Linux port, I was GitHub to get the Windows port working, we did the C key, which was a little extension that you could extra features in Blender, and we went to SIGGRAPH to show what we are doing. And at that time, maybe all the people ever remember, that was the days of the internet bubble, and in 2000, I couldn't resist. I was still a one-man company with an intern, that was all. And then people were coming to me and saying, Tom, your business is worth $10 million. Can we buy 40% of the shares for $4.5 million investment? Well, why not, right? So let's try this. So in 2000, I suddenly had a company with more than 40 employees in three, 4 months, from 1 to 40. Trying to do something and conquer the market with the concept of having freeware software and commercial services around this. Well, as you know how it went in those days, it was burning money. It was burning money, creating shareholder value. All the games that Silicon Valley is also playing is what we tried to do. And this didn't end well. The company shut down, it got bankrupt. It was a restart for a little while. And then in 2002, the investors told me, Tom, Blender is now going here in the drawer. We will lock it, and it's now ours. You go do something else with your life. And I was like, I'm not going to do something else with my life, right? I want to continue with this Blender project. So I set up a foundation, the non-profit Blender Foundation, and I could get a couple of the Blender websites back because they were under my name and not in the investor's hand. And I launched a plan to buy back the rights of the software to make it open source. And the original rights were still of the investors at that time, but they would agree on making Blender free software, GNU GPL, if we would collect via the community €100,000. After some negotiation, the investors agreed, because nobody would ever pay more for the software than we could. Yeah, to my shock and surprise, we made it in 7 weeks. And we did this all based on principles that were called, at that time, not crowdfunding, but it was called the Street Performer Protocol. And this is the basis of what Kickstarter and Indiegogo started on later. Because we already used pledges, like in that if you say, well, if you make a target of 100K, then you have to pay. And we had multiple levels, people could step in with extras. This was a traditional crowdfunding. There's a great article from this scientist about our historical crowdfundraising. Freak success, or first of a trend. Well, in a way, Blender was a freak success, because it never happened again. I've been contacted a lot by companies who went bankrupt, and then the user said, hey, we want to buy back the code. How did you do this? Or how can we do this? And it never happened. And to my knowledge, there was never a community who could buy back the software. And there's actually the main reason is because I am too stubborn to accept to other people's code. So when I made Blender, there was nothing external. There was no module. There was nothing normal engineering practices of making software. I wrote everything myself. So the IP of Blender was fully owned by the company. If you go to other programs like Lightwave, or you had the Softimage and other 3D programs that stopped, the community would love to buy it back, but the companies don't own the products. What they were using, closed modules and closed libraries. They assembled the software, which they had the right to sell, but they don't own it. Anyway, we had a first Blender conference, and we released Blender as open source in 2002 with the help of the Free Software Foundation Europe, Loic. I don't know if Loic is anywhere, but thanks Free Software Foundation for the support. It was a big step to convert a closed source development environment to a public system. Then, in the period after that, I had to set up an open source project, which was new for me. I knew, of course, how open source works and what the principles are, but how do you manage projects online? How do you work with communities? How do you make decisions? What do people really like? And one of the things that helped really well was me really stepping back a bit. I focused on the business, making sure that there was another book publishing, so I could work on Blender full time. But I let decisions and management and the progress on Blender development, I left it to the community. For example, there was a Tuhopu tree. If there are Finnish people here, they know why it's called Tuhopu. It's an evil tree. There was a fork of Blender where everybody had access to. Everybody. If you wanted to had an idea, just put it in the software. And every 3 months, it was so unstable that we could replace it with another version. But that works fantastic, because there's a threshold for people to come on board. The other thing what the community showed, which was so strong, is they really work on the things that matter for them. And I'm the person from the corporate background a little bit with a vision, like, oh, wow, I want to make games, and I want to have a tool where you have interaction and linear content creation all together in one, which is still a great idea, but maybe 20 years later now, it's getting a little bit more feasible to do that. So instead, developers said, great idea, Tom, but why don't we first fix the modeler? Why don't we first fix the material system and get better texture and better sampling in Blender? So they really focused on the things that matter, and that matter for the users. And that kind of open source dynamics is what I really appreciated and learned from. That was in the first few years. We did a Blender 2.3 release, which had a big improvement on the UI already and became a little bit more usable. So then in 2005, I was ending up with an open source project. And even though I love to work with people and this dynamics of the community, I also noticed that there was something missing. And the typical open source projects tend to become very technical and a little bit anti-user oriented. Developers like to develop and like to have fun, and users are sometimes kept separately. And for my background, because Blender was in-house software, I was always used to have the software, the user, and developers working together on things. And specifically for Blender, because it's a 3D tool, it is essential that you do this. You have to get the creatives to influence how that happens with the technology and how to make it usable. So that's why I thought, let's start a project, Project Orange, where we invite the best 5-6 creatives from the Blender community to Amsterdam, and let them make a compelling, interesting, great animation film, and inspire that way the community of developers online to catch up with development for them, to have this day-to-day interaction. So that became Elephant's Dream, the world's first open movie with a fantastic soundtrack, which is So we were so proud when we made this. If you look back to it now, the animation is a bit clunky and it looks a bit weird and stuff. But don't forget, this was so amazing that we could get from the previous reel, which was mostly cameras going around in 3D models, we suddenly had animated characters with voices who were acting and were telling an interesting, weird story. So for us, Elephant Dream is a milestone. And not only because of the process of working with the developers while we are making the film, but also because we released it as Creative Commons. And we didn't release the film only as Creative Commons, we released everything. From the storyboards, to the textures, to the scripts, to the test versions, to the deleted scenes, to the whole production database of the studio was released. And we could fund that by selling that on a dual box DVD, DVD box where the film was on, but also you could put it on your computer, and it had all the Blender files and the software. You could get every shot, load it, render it yourself, and change it. And that model worked fantastic to share content and to share the technology at the same time. So I thought, it's time to do something more permanent. I want to have a studio again, and I want to have a place where we can put developers and artists together on projects to push Blender further. So I found this little place in the Docklands of Amsterdam's old warehouse. There was a bankrupt company that still had all the crap going there. I could rent it quite cheap. And to say, well, this is where we're going to work and make movies and work on Blender projects. With our main business model, DVDs, right? Just put data on DVDs, which is open source data, but you just sell the distribution and do crowdfunding for more films. For example, Big Bad Bunny. That was the first film we did in the Blender Institute. And now production level really kicked in. Big Bug Bunny, I think people have seen Big Bug Bunny, right? Did you see Big Bug Bunny? I think of all our open movies, Big Bug Bunny has the most views and hits on YouTube of all the films we ever did. And that goes into the hundreds of millions. Because it's a Creative Commons, people pick it up, put it on their own channel, slap advertisement on it, and get 10 or 20 million hits. It's fine, right? Go ahead, do it. Here's a little clip. As you can see, character animation quality and rendering quality improved a lot. The expression of characters was fantastic. Better deformation, especially hair systems. Furry animals was completely hot and big in those days. All the animation studios were doing furry animals. So we want to do furry animals in Blender as well. Horrible. We were accused in those days of promoting violence, right? As somebody called the genre of our movies open source violence, right? Of course, this is cartoon, right? In cartoon movies, you have to do things to make people laugh. And it was a big success for us. So, yeah, so we're moving on. The Blender Institute was doing well. And the software development projects are getting bigger. I could hire a couple of people because of our DVD sales and training, what we did. So I thought, okay, it's time for the big leap. And people who work in open source communities, they all can confirm to you that doing a big leap is a dangerous thing. Usually it doesn't work. And the communities like to have smaller targets. have to tell people, let's do something and then release it next week. Everybody will say, yeah, right? That's awesome. We can do something and release it maybe next month. But if you say, let's do something and then we work on it for 3 years, maybe five, then people will say, why would I do that, right? It's not really inspiring to have this kind of big targets. On the other hand, for Blender, it was essential to do a couple of things to upgrade the UI and to have more modern interaction in the software. That is called the non-modal parallel workflow. For example, this is how Blender 2.5 looked like. The software became not only visible, more modern, it was also a pleasure to work with because everything kept working. If, for example, you have your menu popping up, it still could do the preview renders in the back, which was threaded, and it could update the viewports. So everything was done and developed in a way that it always would keep working. Whatever you do, even when you type a text in a button, everything in the UI stays responsive. And that's that makes working with software much more pleasure. And this is standard many softwares nowadays have, so Blender needed it as well. Meanwhile, we had Syntel coming. The Syntel was at that time the biggest ambitious project we did, and we ended up with a fantastic story with a real scriptwriter, with a young director who's genius, he's fantastic. And so we spent much attention to the story development, and it really became the darling of open source films. Especially when the film was taken down a couple of years ago by Sony, accidentally, because they had some music crap going on, like we won't have it for this version. But Sony took it down, it was for 4 or 5 days, the talk of the internet. And suddenly we found out that people really, really appreciated this film. Of course, it had lots of views online, but it is considered to be part of our free culture. It is a free culture movie because it's open source, done with open source, and we share everything as we usually do. And people closed it in their hearts. And it looked fantastic. It was such a nice film where we show that with open source software and with the community to help us out. And with normal people, great artists, but just people like you and me can make a film like that. Okay, moving on. At that time, what I would like to note, in 2011, we started the Blender Network because there was suddenly more interest for professionals to use Blender. And the Blender Network was a website where people could connect and also offer services. Because everybody who's using software always says, especially for open source, that is nice, it's free. But where can I get the support? Where can I have somebody to explain to me how it works? Or where can I get help when I have a bug and I want to have it fixed? Or how can I get a new feature in Blender? Or can somebody make me a script? All of that is what people can get access to via the network. Because the Blender organization is way too small to do all this support. And we have a worldwide community. They should do all that business. Then I can focus on making movies and working on the software. Another big milestone in 2011 was our render engine Cycles. This is seen as blender developer Brecht van Lommel. And he took a break, and after half a year he came back and said, Tom, look at what we have here. And that was Cycles. And Cycles is a ray tracer doing physically based rendering, high quality rendering using surface definitions, BSDF they call it, that are actually representations of how light scatters on surfaces. It's a formula for light distribution between surfaces. So you can use that for ray tracing to create photorealistic effects. And suddenly technology was far enough, thanks to CPUs and multithreading and GPUs, that you could also have ray tracing and this high quality rendering to be part of a 3D program and have it in the viewport, have it real time almost. So that's what we combined with another film, that's the Tears of Steel. Not only we use cycles for photorealistic rendering, what you need for visual effects films, that is with motion tracking, and that means that you can track if somebody moves, that you can have an eye, and then put a motor on it or something. A camera reconstruction is important because you want to have, based on footage, you want to know where is the filterable camera, so I can add like monsters in a scene to walk around. Masking, compositing, all things you need to do visual effects. So this was a sci-fi film playing in Amsterdam, where the last of mankind has been locking themselves up in an old church, getting attacked by evil robots who were taking over the world, and fighting with their last bits of hope. Watch it online. Watch it online. So, that time, we're going to 2013, and I thought, let's have a feature film project. But there were now small studios around the world using Blender, from America to Australia and all the way. And let's see if we can create some kind of network and make a relay movie, where everybody makes a part and then moves to the production, moves to the next studio. That was Project Gooseberry. The funding target was also extreme. We needed a lot of people to support this, to be able to do this. And we did a two-month campaign, and we didn't make it. There was not enough interest and motivation in the community to do something at this scale. So that didn't work, but what did work were two other milestones. One was we started for this initiative the Blender Cloud. But instead of having data on plastic and do business with that, people want to have it online and accessible. So why would you want to have all your open source Creative Commons data on a piece of plastic? That's useless. So we made a website with gigabytes of data with the whole history of the Blender studios, and people could get access to that for $10 per month. Not only they would get access to the old films, but we would use that subscription model to fund the next films as well. That's how we did Cosmos Laundromat in 2015, which was another level up in quality for rendering and with the style and with the direction and everything. And this really got us the industry, including people from ILM and Disney, to look at what we are doing. Do the dialogue myself. But Cosmos Laundromat is of course online. You should watch it. We are currently investigating Cosmos Laundromat 2, with the second part, but this can become a open source series, like a TV series, but then done with open source software and shared in Creative Commons. And in this scene, the guy with the orange hair tries to convince the sheep that he is so much more than a sheep. And he can get a much better life if he can have a little device on his neck and then, etc. You should watch it, it's beautiful. So this little reel is something that's very popular online in the Venom community. This is a breakdown, we call it. It shows how it works in a studio to use 3D software to make parts of movies. And you see experiments and tests, because one of the highlights of the Cosmos Laundromat is a big colorful tornado that comes down and picks up the sheep and sucks it into an alternative dimension. As you can see, a lot of attention also went to simulation technology. It's very popular on universities to have young students working on open source libraries for fluid simulation, for smoke simulation, for hair simulation, for grass, for wind, everything that's part of natural phenomena are part of a good 3D environment. Another film we did in 2015 was the comedy film with the llama getting into some kind of fight with a penguin. To see how it ends, you can go online. And as if it was nothing, we thought, I thought especially, I want to have that feature film anyway, so we are going to do it in a different way. Instead of working with a lot of small studios around the world, let's try to get something built in our own place in Amsterdam, expand the business with a film studio to make an open source pipeline for production. Complete 100% free open source pipeline for making animation film based on Blender, of course, and with other tools. I got the rights of a famous Dutch comic series, it's also quite well known in Belgium and in Germany. This is Agent 327, it's a Dutch spy who's not an 007, so he has no license to kill, there's no budget. He's in Holland, but there are lots of international conspiracies of people who come to Amsterdam to get stuff done. So it's adventurous and comedy, target audience a little bit more than youth, because we really like to explore making animation film for a more adult audience.
Please. Such a lovely place you've got here. Is it usually this empty?
Oh yeah, this project, this was fantastic. It turned lots of heads. It looks fantastic. This looks like a commercial feature film. And I was busy and ready to go around the world and sell it, to get funding for it. But something else happened, and that, of course, was Blender 2.8. There was another big leap scheduled already since 2014, is to get Blender to another level, to really look at industry compatibility, easier ways to configure it, workflow as a main theme, and having real-time photorealistic work in the viewport. And so that you work on things, just like if you have a modern game engine that are looking almost photorealistic, you should be able to work, create things in an environment as if it looks real. And that's what modern 3D software does. And another innovation that made Blender important for a lot of studios is the grease pencil. You will see a little demos of that later, where you can draw in 3D. At first, when people thought of what, why would I draw in 3D? Well, it's genius. It's what storyboarders like, but also fashion designers, car designers, character and creature designers. But if you can draw it very well, and you can use 3D lines in your environment, you can do crazy things. All of this project for 2.8, it went way, way too slow. It was dragging on and on and on, and I thought, maybe it's better to drop this feature film for a little while and focus on organizing 2.8 better. So we did another interesting campaign, which was we had a little rocket token with a USB drive with some things on it. And we sold 3,200 rockets for €40 each in like within 2 weeks. And that gave us plus some sponsors from the corporate sponsors from the market, gave us money to get all the core developers from Blender for 3 months to come to Amsterdam to get this whole 2.8 project working. And we got room for a bigger studio in Amsterdam. And this is me going around showing the place.
Local souvenir, Fritz Martin, and the classroom. We come with the weekly room, start off with some painting, and then here the best place, my room, of course. We have a Webby, but of course a Sega Award. If you get somewhere you can really make use of, the dishwasher is busy, of gold, confident. Those are all the tools, paint, crap. I use the glass prisms. Where we lost.
Chairman.
Oh, but he doesn't like to be in the most important room. Our server room. Ah, that's the ant. The creative team.
The cat.
The cat is very cool.
If you are in Amsterdam and you want to drop by, let us know, because we always like to have short tours, 5 minutes maybe, but it's a fun place to see. As a result, we could make a Blender 2.8 beta at least. In that summer 2018, the first beta version was released, which was usable. But things were slowing down again, because everybody went back home and could notice that what we were missing a really a core team of people who work together to do more complicated things. So I thought we have to reorganize the way how we do donations within Blender. And that's when we started up or restarted the Blender Development Fund, which is a membership program, a little bit inspired by Linux Foundation. It has badges for users, and people can do small donations every month, and you get a badge that shows up when you post things on the Blender website. But also with a corporate membership program with a little bit of added benefits, such as that you can directly email me, or you get a Blender developer contact that can help you if you want to get better onboarded. But the goal of the development fund is solely to fund core development and do all the back-end stuff like bug fixing, patch reviewing, and making releases. When 2019 started, like with a bang, we got the Annie Award. Within the animation industry, the Annie Award is top. This is the best award what they give to software companies or to people who do technology. The Up iWorks Awards. We had the award with us to the Blender conference, and people could have a little glamour photographer making a picture with the award. We're also working on a feature film, a short film called Spring, which was in development when 2.8 was also being developed. So the artists were using every day the latest checkout of Master with all the bugs and all the issues and giving feedback on the usability and the stability of the software. So Spring is a beautiful, poetic fairy tale about a girl who has to bring spring to the world. I can only advise you to watch it with good sound at your home cinema. We also have prepared a little clip with a breakdown of like how things work. I think I'm running out of time, so I'm going to skip this part. Well, another thing happened last year, that was the Epic grant. Epic announced that they had $1.2 million reserved for Blender. I don't have it on the bank. I mean, this is being given in small parts over 3 years' time, which is better for us, of course. Epic wants us to help, wants us to make Blender a more professional development, to get development more professional for Blender. That means that we do better onboarding, with more engineering practices, and that kind of things. And then we did the 2.8 Blender release. And this is what you see. This is the 3D drawing tools that you can do in Blender. You can have 2D drawing, 2D animation, and 3D animation combined. You can draw 3D models and convert them into 3D. The Blender Development Fund like exploded with 5 times more donations in per year time. The Blender Development Fund is going to $1 million, over $1 million per year that we get in, and it's only growing. So yes, we warm, right? We, everybody likes Blender, everybody wants to be involved with Blender, but what that mean for us? Eh? But there is now a big transition going on in the Blender community and in the Blender organization that suddenly, because corporate contributors are coming on board, they have a different way of working. So how do we avoid separating the community, which is important for Blender, from the professionals? The professionals say, yeah, I don't mind having a paid bug tracker, and then you can have a bug tracker for the poor people. I don't like that, right? I would like to find ways to have the industry not saying, join us, that I'm going to be part of the industry. I want the industry to be part of the Blender project. So I would like to close with a question which I was asking myself last year as well. Like, why do people use Blender? And I'm here at an open source conference, but I think the answer will surprise you. So for example, I was at a NAC conference, it's an animators conference. Lots of young people there, people 18, 19, 20 years. They were all looking at me. Apparently they knew me and they know Blender, and they're all like, oh wow, Tom, yeah, we love Blender. We use it at school, we use it everywhere. Even though our teachers don't use it, we are using it. And I asked them, but why? What? Why are you using it? Because you are young and you can get any cracked and hacked and whatever software you want. Well, they said, it is because of the community. The community is what ties us. So the community is why they are using it. It means if you go online and you want to know anything of Blender, you find out via the community. Everything on 3D is about Blender. Everything is public, the people share. It is in the community spirit to do that. I have to hurry up. And I also asked the same question to professionals at studios who are using Blender. And they said, we use Blender because you guys care, right? And that's right, we care. Open source makers care. We care about the product, we care about the users, and we care about things. And the last thing, and that is why I was telling the story, the Blender project has a story, and people like to be involved with stories. And that's my final slide. This is a famous brand diagram, the golden circle. And it says, if you make a product, the what, then you first have to look at the why. So why are people doing things? And open source is not in the core. But the open source is the how. And open source is how people can connect with technology. That was it. Thank you.
Thank you.